I want you to turn in your Bibles to 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 3 through 5. Now, you know this passage, and I've dealt with this passage probably for the last few weeks, but I need to go deeper into it now, if I may. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 3 through 5, and the word reads this way, and I'm reading out of the New King James Version right now. The Bible reads this way. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war according to the flesh. Now we all agree on that. We don't walk in the flesh. We walk in the flesh, but we don't war according to the flesh. We understand that. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God for pulling down strongholds. So our weapons of our warfare are not carnal, they're not fleshly, they're not something that comes out of us, but they are mighty in God for pulling down strongholds. That means they're spiritual weapons, weapons that go beyond the flesh, that God uses that are mighty in God for pulling down strongholds. Now, we've talked about strongholds, and we've talked about the weapons of our warfare. We talked about no weapon formed against us shall prosper. We've talked about all those things here recently in the past. But I want to go to verse 5. In verse 5 it says, now this is after we realize that our weapons are not fleshly and our weapons are spiritual and that they are mighty in God for the pulling down of strongholds, we begin to understand that. Then we go to verse 5, it says, casting down arguments and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. Wow. Bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. So let's read this passage again with those three things in our mindset. 2 Corinthians 10, 3 through 5. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war according to the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God for pulling down strongholds, casting down arguments and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. I believe God's going to touch your life this morning if you take this word and you began to let it get into inside of you, into your heart and your spirit. Father, I thank you for your goodness and your grace and your mercy toward our lives. I thank you for this word. I thank you, Father, as we delve into what you've given me to speak on this morning, that, Father, you'll speak to every heart and mind and spirit, that this word, Father, will be a seed, that it'll find good ground this morning in the hearts of those who are listening. And Father, that it will be watered by your precious Holy Spirit. And that, Father, it will grow into a plant and bear fruit. But Father, we ask for more than just fruit this morning. We ask for good fruit, Father, to come. And we ask, Father, this morning for more than just good fruit. We ask for good fruit that will remain in our lives. And we speak it forth, Father, right now in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. And we agree upon it right now as a fellowship of believers. In the name of Jesus we pray. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus we pray. And everybody says, amen. Amen. As we get into this passage, the first thing that I want to do is I want to go into verse 4 where it says, for the pulling down of strongholds, to build a foundation that I want to speak on about the arguments and the high things. As we get into the end of verse 4, it says, pulling down of strongholds, our weapons are not carnal, but they're mighty in God. They're spiritual. They're mighty in God for the pulling down of strongholds. This word pulling down right here literally means demolition. But in a broader sense, it means complete destruction. For the pulling down of strongholds. In other words, it's the complete destruction of the stronghold in your life. And in its most strict sense, I mean the most serious sense of this word, it means ground to dust. So basically what the word is saying here, that the weapons of warfare are not carnal, they are spiritual, they're not fleshly, they're spiritual, but they are mighty in God for the pulling down of strongholds. In other words, we need to take the strongholds in our life and we need to completely destroy them and grind them to dust. Just don't tear the wall down. Just don't win the war. A lot of times we win the battle and we win the war against a situation in our life or a stronghold in our life, and we stand there with that and we begin to shout victory, and we leave the remnants of that stronghold right there where it was. We leave the stones there. We leave the foundation there. We've tore the walls down. We tore the roof down. We've raised it all the way down to the ground. But there's still elements of that stronghold there in your life. And we're proclaiming victory, and we did have a victory right there, but I want you to have a victory that's going to go beyond today, that will go into tomorrow and into the future and into your children. And to do that, we had to pull down the strongholds. And that means not just knock the walls down, but we had to take every stone, anything that resembles that stronghold in your life, and we have to grind that thing to dust. That means you're going to have to take some things out of your life. That means you're going to have to rearrange some things. That means you're going to have to begin to do things differently in your life. So you've pulled down the stronghold. You've attacked the situation. You've attacked the problem. But now let's grind it to dust till there is nothing left that even remotely resembles the stronghold that was in your life. Then it will not transfer into your future. And then it will not transfer over to your kids. If you're not careful, you're going to allow strongholds that you've tore down to be rebuilt by the enemy in your life and possibly even transfer it over to your children and rebuilt in their lives. And I don't know about you, but I want my children to be blessed. I want my grandchildren to be blessed. I want the people in my church family and those I'm in contact with, I want them all to be blessed. I want you to grind that thing to dust. Get mad at it. Just don't shout victory and say, oh, praise God, I want a little victory right here. Hallelujah. And then go out and begin to allow the enemy to rebuild that because you left all the materials there. You tore the wall down, but you left all the materials that he needed to rebuild. Get rid of it all. Get rid of it all. If you have a problem with pornography, then you need to get rid of everything around you that gives you access to it. If you have a problem with drinking, you need to get rid of anything around you that gives you access to that. If you have a problem with drugs, you got to get rid of anything that has access to that. If you have a problem with forgiveness, then you need to begin to get rid of anything around you that causes you not to be able to forgive. Grind it to dust. Grind it to dust. That's what the pulling down means. Grind that bad boy to dust. And then in verse 5, after he says, for God, for the pulling down of strongholds, in other words, I want you to grind those strongholds to dust, he looks down and he says, casting down arguments. That phrase casting down means to remove with force. I'm pulling down the stronghold, and any argument that comes up against me, I remove it with force. Anything that comes against the knowledge of God, anything that comes against what God's placed in my heart, I come against it with force. In other words, when that stronghold tries to come back, we pulled down the strongholds, we've ground it to dust, now we've got to cast down the arguments. And when those things come into my heart and they come into my spirit that I know that I've been delivered from and I know that I've walked away from, I need to look at that thing, and I don't need to just speak quietly to it. I need to speak to it in force. I tell you right now, I will not get mad. I am not going to open my mouth and say something I shouldn't say. Now somebody needs to say amen to that one. I am not going to lose my temper. I'm not going to fly off the handle. In fact, I come against that in the name of Jesus, and I come against it with force. I'm just not saying, oh, I hope I'm not going to lose my temper. Oh, I hope I don't do this again. Oh, I hope I don't pick up that cigarette again. I hope I don't pick up that joint. Oh, I hope I don't pick up those drugs. Oh, I hope I don't drink alcohol again. Oh, I hope I don't cuss again. I hope I don't get in a situation where I can't forgive these people again. We get all this stuff going on inside of us. Hey, when that begins to come up, I don't look at it and say, oh, I hope. I look at it and say, I will not. I will not allow that. I am not going to allow that fear. We cast it down violently with force. We get on top of it. We mean business. We mean business. So every time that comes in, every time an argument or every high thing exalts itself against the knowledge of God, I take that thing and I cast it down with force. Well, if I'm supposed to be casting these things down with force, exactly what are all the things that I'm casting down with force? Well, the word I had you write down earlier was the word arguments. And the word arguments the literal translation is imaginations. And we all got an imagination. Some of you out there got a big imagination. Because you imagine all kinds of things that aren't there. I'm going to tell you right now. You can imagine. Some of you guys are fearful and you worry and you worry and you worry about things that don't even exist. That don't even exist. I know with the coronavirus thing going around, there's plenty of cause for concern. And we've taken our precautions and we're doing what everybody's doing what they need to be. At least many people are. There's some people that aren't, but many people are. But some of us have, some of us build up things into our imagination. We have a little lady in the church who was scared to death to go to the grocery store. She's a beautiful, beautiful, beautiful lady and just as sweet as pie. And she was afraid to go to the grocery store because of all the horror stories that you hear at the grocery stores right now because of what's going on. And she had to go to the grocery store. She finally got the courage up and she actually jumped on our Marco Polo and said, hey, everybody pray for me. And people prayed for her and spoke a positive word in her life. And she got up and she went to the grocery store and she come back and she said, you know what? It wasn't all that bad. So what happened was that the fear and the anxiety of having to go to that store because of the coronavirus and everything that was going on and how people seemed to storm the stores at certain times was building up her because she kept on hearing these negative reports and these negative reports and these negative reports. And so she got out there, and when she got out there, she realized all the reports that she was receiving weren't really accurate at all. Now, some of it was true, obviously, but the biggest majority of it was not accurate at all. And what happened was her imagination was building up. And every one of us do the same thing. We're afraid to move. We're afraid to do something. And the devil gets in our mind and he begins to build it up and build it up. It's about that big. It's about that big. And by the time the devil gets finished with it, it's about that big. And so it's imaginations. So he's saying we need to violently, with force, cast down those imaginations. Now the next thing that this means, if you break it down, and you break it down beyond imaginations, the word arguments means our reasonings, our judgment, and our pretense. Our reasonings, our judgment, and our pretense. You see, this word argument is tied closely. Now I want you to listen to this. It's tied closely, and if I can put it this way, it's even knitted together with Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5. As Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5 speaks to our own understanding. Trust in the Lord with all of your heart and lean not on your own understanding. This phrase, your own understanding, right here is closely knitted and closely tied to the word arguments and imaginations. Once again, it speaks to our personal knowledge, our personal reasonings, our judgments, and our discernment. So if we tie those together, which they tie together, when the Bible says, do not lean on your own understanding, then the Bible is serious about that. Do not lean on your own understanding. Do not lean on your own knowledge. Don't lean on your own reasonings. Don't lean on your own judgments. Don't lean on your own imaginations. Don't lean on your own discernments. Don't lean on your own heart. Can I tell you this morning, listen to me, your heart is deceitful. Your heart will deceive you. So, Pastor Allen, I don't believe that. Your heart will deceive you because your heart is tied to your emotions. And your emotions fluctuate all over the place. One minute you're happy, one minute everything's okay, and the future looks bright. 10 minutes later, somebody says something that makes you mad, and everything, and all of a sudden your future isn't the your emotions go way down, and all of a sudden you're way down here somewhere, and now everything's bad, and you're about to give up. 30 minutes later, your emotions are back up here. Your heart's all over the place. Your heart is deceitful. It deceives you. It fools you. Your emotions fluctuate all over the place. Can you see? Your understanding, let me put this, your understanding cannot see the overall picture. Your understanding can't. So don't lean on your own understanding. Don't lean on your own understanding. Cast down arguments. Don't lean on your own understanding. You see, you can't see the whole picture of what God sees. You only see what happened yesterday and what's happening right now. You don't see what God has got laid out. He's got things going on for you right now that you know not of. But there's one thing I do know. I do know this one thing. I know that my God never lies. And I know that my God never changes. He's the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow, and he'll be that way to the end of time. I know that he'll never lie, because he's a God of truth. I know that he'll never change. So what was right yesterday is right today, and it'll be right tomorrow. What was wrong yesterday is wrong today, and will be wrong tomorrow. I can know with all confidence that my God is omniscient, and he knows everything from the past, present, and he knows what's going to take place tomorrow. I need to learn that I do not need to lean on my own knowledge and my own understanding. I do not need to rely upon my deceitful heart and my fluctuating emotions and my lack of understanding of the whole picture that's around me. I need to learn that I need to trust in God. I need to put my trust in Him. Most of the time we feel overwhelmed by life. We feel overwhelmed by life and the circumstances because we still are leaning on our own understanding. We're still allowing our emotions to be our measure. Oh, Lord, you're allowing your heart and what you see to be your measure. If your emotions and your heart and what you see are your measure, you're going to be twisty-tailed upside down for the rest of your days. If you make your decisions off of your emotions, your decisions strictly off your heart, your emotions strictly off of what you see, you're going to be in trouble tomorrow. You probably were in trouble yesterday, and you'll be in trouble today, and you're probably in trouble tomorrow because you're leaning on the wrong things. You're putting your trust in the wrong things. With force, you cast down the argument. You cast down what you see and the understanding. You cast down your emotions and that heart over that situation. Don't make an emotional decision. You make a God decision. You make a decision out of faith. The word argument here does not only refer to our own understanding, reasonings, and judgments. But it also refers to the pretense of our imaginations, the pretense of our understanding, the pretense of our emotions, the pretense of our heart. And the word pretense is an attempt to make something that is not the case to appear true. In other words, pretense is a mask. Pretense is a mask that you wear to cover who you really are. I'm speaking to somebody today, and I want you to listen to me. You're walking with a pretense. It's an argument. The Bible's telling us to cast that thing down. In other words, the Bible's saying, take off your mask. Well, Pastor Al, if I take off my mask, the whole world will see who I am and what I am. Then the whole world needs to see who you are and what you are. And if the people, and if they're really your friends, if they're really your family, if they're really for you and not against you, they will love you, show you grace and mercy, and pick you up and hold you because they love you, because they see you. But if you keep on putting on the mask, you're going to be miserable for the rest of your days. You have a mask on covering up who you really are because you're afraid if people know who you really are, they won't love you or accept you. So you're always wearing a mask. This is telling us, don't yield to that. Take the mask off. Take the mask off. Remember what it said? We demolish every argument. We demolish every pretense. We demolish every ask, every mask. We demolish every pretense that sets itself up against the knowledge of God. When you wear your mask, you're setting yourself against God and the knowledge of God because you're showing something that isn't real to the world around you. Now the next thing is every high thing. It says every high thing that exalts itself against God. Arguments and high things. And every high thing is speaking to our vanity and our sufficiency. It speaks to two things. The first thing it speaks to is our vanity and our sufficiency. We feel that we're self-sufficient, so we don't need provision. And because everything's going good in our life, we don't feel like we really need to submit to certain parts of the Word of God because we have everything under control. Those are high things. Those are high things. They're made in high places. Those are high things where you set yourself above the Word of God. You set yourself above what God is speaking into your life. You're full of vanity. What you're doing, you're setting yourself on high. When you set yourself above other people and you set yourself above all, you're setting yourself on high. And he said, he cast down arguments in every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. You see, the Bible says we're brothers and sisters. We're all one. We kneel at the cross at the same cross. We kneel on the same ground. We're covered by the same blood. So I don't care what your social status is. I don't care what your nationality is. I don't care what your skin color is. It does not matter. We all kneel at the same cross, covered by the same blood. We all bleed the same color blood. And when we set ourselves above our brothers and sisters, sure, we have different positions in life and there's different authorities in life, but when we take that and we exercise it with vanity, we set ourselves above God because we're all on equal ground when it comes to God. Just because you're president of the United States doesn't mean you have special favor with God. You have special favor with God because you're yielding to God and God gives you special favor. Just because you're in the Senate, or just because you're a representative, just because you're a pastor, just because you're a deacon, just because you're a teacher, doesn't give you special relationship with God. We're all on the same ground when it comes to God. And when I set myself and exalt myself above my brothers and my sisters, I'm creating a high thing. Does that make sense? I'm creating a high thing, and it exalts itself against God. So it says, cast those things down with force. Cast that thing down. It's also speaking to philosophy that exalts itself above God. So any philosophy that says Christ is not the way, any philosophy that says there's another way to have salvation, there's another way to heaven, there's another way you can do this or that through without repentance of your sins through the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, that's a high thing. It sets itself above God. So it's setting itself against God. As it does that, I don't care if it's another religion or just your personal philosophy or your personal thought. If it sets it, if you set yourself above God's word in that and it doesn't agree with God's word, it's a high thing and it needs to be torn down. You need to violently come against it. You need to, with force, come against it. And so we speak to it with force to the enemy that's in our life. This is why Paul writes in Ephesians chapter 6, and you know this passage. But this passage is also, this right here, when it talks high things, also speaks to the devil and his demonic legions of hell that war against our souls every day. So that's another high thing, because remember, Satan's sin was his pride, and he tried to take the throne of God. He tried to elevate himself above God, and even to this day, he is still trying to do it. It's a high thing. That's why Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12 says, for we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. So, all pride, all vanity, and all communion with the devil in your life must stop. If you want to grind the strongholds to dust, it must stop. Every stronghold, every pretense, every mask, every argument, all your pride, all your vain thoughts, and all your communion with the enemy must be torn down, demolished, and ground to dust in your life. I cast it down. I pull down that stronghold, and I cast down the arguments, and I cast down every high thing, all my vanity, and all my communion with the enemy. And I grind it to dust. Then it says, bringing every thought into captivity. The word thought right there means every perception, every purpose. It means our mental processes. It speaks to every implication of your mind on how you think. The battle begins in your mind, how you think. Don't use the very condemnation the enemy is using to describe you to describe yourself. Don't use the same condemnation the enemy's bringing into your life to describe you to describe yourself. So I become aware of those thoughts and I take them captive. The word captive means to hold something, but more than just hold something, but to hold something and lead it towards something else. So I pull down the strongholds, demolish them, grind them to dust. I cast down the arguments and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, and I bring every thought, get thought into captivity. I exercise all these things, and then I take them prisoner. And I lead them somewhere. Say, Pastor, where do you take it? The last part of that verse, to the obedience of Christ. I pull down those strongholds. I grind them to dust. I take every argument, every pretense, all my own understanding, every high thing, all my vanity, all my pride, all my philosophies, everything that I have, every thought that comes to my mind, I take all of these things into captivity and I lead them to the cross. And I lay them at the feet of Jesus, whom is my burden bearer. And I say, God, here it is.
I tear down every stronghold. I cast down every argument and high thing that would exalt itself against you. I bring every thought, Father, into captivity. And I bring it and I'm laying it at your feet. And God will lift the burden off your shoulder. And when He lifts it off His shoulder, don't go back to it. Have you ever noticed that every time you get involved in your situation, you mess it up? Because you're acting on your heart and your emotion, on the knowledge that you see? Listen to me. I love you this morning. I want you to have a great life. I want you to be happy and secure. I want you to have joy and peace. So take all these things captive and take them to the cross. Let God take care of your situation. Trust in Him. Lean not on your understanding. Remember Proverbs, lean not on your understanding. Trust God. Put your trust in God. I promise you, God knows more about you and your situation than you ever thought. And He's speaking to you right now because you're carrying a heavy burden. You're that person that has that mask. You're the person that is running on your emotions and your heart and your feelings, and you fluctuate all over the place. You don't even know what you think anymore because you fluctuate so much. You're the person who has won a victory on many occasions, but you've never completely ground the stronghold to dust. You're the person who hasn't gotten violent in your response to the enemy speaking into your life. Take that enemy, chain him up, and take it to the cross. And let Christ lift that burden off your life. And when the enemy tries to come back in and place these things back in because that burden's been lifted off, you rebuke it. Cast it down. Take it captive. Take it back to the cross. You keep taking the enemy to the cross, he's going to get tired of coming around. Because that's the last place he wants to be. So you're out there with me right now. I just want you to bow your head wherever you're at. If you have some people around you, if you have your family around you, I just want y'all to come close. I know the corona thing says don't hold hands, but if you're in your family situation there, hold up in your house, and you feel comfortable with it, I just encourage you to join hands. Father, I speak over every heart and life this morning that's listening to this. That, Father, they've been struggling with the very things that I spoke about. They've been struggling with the pretense and the masks. They're struggling, Father, with the heart and the emotions and the things that are around them. They're just all over the place. They're having a hard time with their thought life. They've had victories, but they seem to be short-lived because the strongholds aren't completely destroyed. Father, they're facing uncertain times and they don't know what they're going to do tomorrow, Father. I just pray that you begin to speak to the heart, that they don't need to lean on their own understanding, but trust in you. The people, Father, are sitting there with me right now that have tried to fix this thing and try to fix it and try to fix it, and every time they try to fix it, it gets worse. But Father, you'll give them the strength to take all these things captive and bring them to your altar, bring them to the cross. So, Father, right now, everything that we're bringing right now, we're gathering all our stuff that shouldn't be there, and we come at the foot of the cross right now, and I just plead the blood of Jesus over it right now. Father, I just ask you right now, just lift that burden off. Right now, I just want you to say it with your mouth. Say, Father, I am so sorry that I have held on to all this stuff. and I give it to you. Give me strength to take everything captive. Give me strength to strike down every argument. Give me strength to pull down the strongholds and grind them to dust. I need you. And I lay myself at your feet. Give me strength. Give me strength. Give me peace. Give me my joy back. And Father, repeat it after me. And Father, if any thought comes to my mind that is contrary to the word of God, I will take it captive and I will lead it to this cross until the enemy is tired of kneeling at your cross and at your feet. Amen.